the emerging COVID-19 variants, Delta variant, for example, Delta Plus, we've pinned our hopes on the ramp up of vaccination, the key part of everyone's recovery strategy all over the world, really. But now that we're seeing new variants that might overtake, you know, the vaccines that we currently have, does that concern you enough for you to revisit your recovery projections?
I'm very optimistic on the pace of our vaccination and the willingness of people to be vaccinated, unlike other countries where that really is a problem. For example, in the US, about half of them don't want to be vaccinated, and that's where the variants come in, right? At least in the Philippines, people are willing to be vaccinated. And we have, you know, there are many reasons why we should be optimistic. The vaccines are coming, and we have multiple sources of vaccines, unlike other countries where they have only one or two sources of vaccines. We have, if I remember right, 7, plus now the J&J is coming. And so with the willingness of Filipinos to be vaccinated and the coming in of multiple sources of vaccines, I think we'll be doing fine. So because really the solution to this economic problem is the vaccine. Because once we part of our population, we can start opening up the economy. And we have done that now, slowly opening up the economy. And that will bring about higher consumer and business confidence. And so at the same time, we are focused on our structural reforms, where we don't let the COVID pandemic get in the way of our structural reforms.
Governor, two things there. One, yes, the vaccines are coming, but now there are questions raised that the seeds of doubt have been planted whether the vaccines are effective against the new variants. Secondly, and in relation to that, a majority of our vaccines are now coming from Sinovac from China, and some countries have raised concerns over the efficacy of these Chinese vaccines against the new variant. You're not at all concerned, sir?
No, we're now getting a lot of AstraZeneca. We're getting J&J, and Pfizer is coming. You know, the statistics in the U.S. is very telling. 95% of those who are now infected have not been vaccinated. So as long as we get our focus on the right track and we keep on vaccinating our people, and we're the pace of vaccination is increasing from 250,000 daily to the idea is to have it ramp up to about 500,000 daily.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's look at what the central banks are doing, sir. Investors now seem to be slowly starting to price in divergence from central banks. You guys seem to be ready to do your own thing, not necessarily follow the Fed. Do you think so, sir? Are you ready to walk down a different rate path? And how, if ever yes, how do you think that will impact assets across the board?
You know, the Philippines is now very different from where it was, say, 20 years ago or even earlier. I've seen so many crises in my life. I mention this all the time. And whenever there's a crisis, we run out of dollars, okay? Because we have a huge foreign debt. And as a result, we have to adjust our interest rates to stem the flow of the outflow of dollars. That's not the case anymore. We have a hefty gross international reserves, and we have multiple sources of foreign exchange coming in. We have the OFW remittances, we have the BPO receipts, and the foreign direct investments are continue to come in. So I'm not worried about the Fed's interest rates going up. And that will cause a lot of problems, admittedly, for other emerging economies, but not for the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. So you're not under pressure, sir, because a lot of the analysts we talk to say, you know, when the Fed starts to raise, we're going to have to follow whatever happens. No, you don't think so?
That's true for, as I said, other emerging economies, which right now have a huge debt to GDP ratio. And so they'll be under a lot of pressure. Under that kind of situation, not the Philippines. our debt to GDP ratio, even after the massive borrowing for the COVID, is around 60%. And that is still significantly lower than what I call sustainable rate of borrowing for the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. So, sir, you think maybe if you look past the next 6 to 12 months, are you seeing any changes, major changes in your policy?
We are, the BSP, as I always say, is data dependent. And mm-hmm. we look at international developments, we look at the local developments. And so I'm comfortable that we'll continue to be supportive of the economy, given that the economy is still at its nascent recovery phase. I think we'll see a big positive for the second quarter. There will be a strong second half of the year, and so let's see from there whether we will make some adjustments in our policy.
Okay. Final question, Governor. We're back to the global dirty money watchdogs gray list, like Haiti, Malta, and South Sudan. Not exactly the best company to have, but where yes. do you think where do you think that we slip? And what's being done now?
No, because the evaluation of the Philippines is based not only on the technical compliance, but on effectiveness compliance. We have to demonstrate effective implementation of the things we have done. And we've done a lot. And in fact, there's no more actions on the part of Congress that we need. It's to demonstrate effective compliance in some 18 action items. Mm-hmm. And that's, if I remember right, they started from 80, and now it's down to 18 international cooperative review group action plan items. And unfortunately, some of these items are easy to comply with, others are more difficult. And they've given us until January of 2023, some 18 months to comply with some of these action plans. And right now, we are under enhanced monitoring or gray list. That's not bad as long as we're given, as I said, 18 months to comply with it. And so with that, as I said, there's a varying degree of difficulty on how to comply. I'll give you an example of what I consider to be easy. For example, item number 18. There are some 18 action items. Number 18 is easy to me. It says demonstrate that supervisors undertake risk-based, or no, rather, issue a step-by-step guidance for delisting and freezing procedures and publish it widely. That could be complied with before the end of the year, easily, mm-hmm. all right? But there are some more difficult.
What's the items. Difficult one, sir?
I'll give you an example of a difficult one, item number 14, I think. It says, or rather, item number 7, demonstrate an increase in investigations and prosecutions in accordance with Philippine risk profile, including crimes with transnational element and or foreign proceeds, and using formal and informal international cooperation when necessary. Okay, you know, the wild card here, why it's 18 months, is because there is an intervening election next year.
So
we could have complied with this within say 1 year, but because of the intervening election, we expect some changes in the officials of what you call the law enforcement agencies, like the PNP, the FBI, the NBI, and the Bancor, for example, and even SEC. So we provided for that. So in the event that there is a change in leadership, then we can still meet the deadline. What makes a lot of difference is if we don't meet the deadline by January 2023. So we have to demonstrate effectiveness, no longer compliance of legislation, etc. That's done. It's compliance.
Okay. Governor, for anyone who's just reading the headline about this story, they're probably asking, now that the Philippines was re-included in the gray list, does it mean that Is it safe to assume that there were money laundering and terrorist financing activities that happened during the pandemic? Would that be a safe assumption, sir?
No, there's always been such incidents, and we continue to monitor them. So
Was there an increase in such incidences?
We don't know that, whether there's an increase, but one reform that I have introduced as chairman of the anti-money laundering is that we are applying artificial intelligence, okay? AI. We're acquiring such capability, because it's hard to monitor all this. As you know, every time you deposit more than $500,000, that's supposed to be reported to us. And so, but at the same time, even if it's less than $500,000, if there's a pattern, that is also reported. But if you can't do that manually. It has to be through an artificial intelligence mechanism. So we are upgrading our technology, and we are hiring more people to really monitor all these events.
Okay. So, Governor, are you confident you're going to meet the 2023 deadline to meet the 18
I'm
actions?
I'm very confident. We're doing it. We're meeting almost every week, and we are coordinating closely with other law enforcement agencies. You know, this is an all of nation approach, because we cannot do it by ourselves. Okay, so we're coordinating with the National Bureau of Investigation, the PNP, the PAGBOR, and right now the real estate. We also have to monitor the real estate, and of course Securities and Exchange Commission. And this is actually coordinated by a body which was created, and the chairman of this is the executive secretary himself, and I'm the vice chair of this body.
Okay. Governor, you're a very, very busy man, always have been, and I think for the next few months. Thank you, sir, for joining us this morning. Have a great week ahead, and do stay safe.
Stay safe, too.